Is mindfulness better than medication? That's what I'm going to be talking about today. I'm Dr. Tracey Marks, a psychiatrist, and this channel is about mental health education and self-improvement. If you don't want to miss a video, click subscribe and the notification bell. This is a follow-up to a video I did on depression and neuroplasticity. And in that video, I mentioned that we now see depression as a poor connection between the neurons. We also recognize that practicing psychotherapy and mindfulness improves that connectivity. Does it work better than medication for depression? It doesn't work as quickly, but the research shows that it can be more effective in the long term without the side effects of medication. Let me explain. Simply put, mindfulness is attention to the here and now. It's being fully present in the moment, and you're experiencing the present moment in a non-judgmental way. Experiencing any given moment is different from thinking about it. We spend a lot more time thinking and processing thoughts than we do experiencing. And your mind is always working and processing a lot of thoughts every day. And thoughts can be your friend if they're creative and help you figure out a problem. But thoughts can be your enemy if they make you worry, ruminate over things, which is thinking about something over and over again. And thoughts can be your enemy if they tell you negative things about yourself. So managing your thoughts is one of the goals of mindfulness. Why does this matter? In an article from Science Magazine in 2010, researchers talked about how the normal default mode of your brain is to wander and think about things from the past and the present. It's called stimulus-independent thought. And although it's the default mode of your brain, it comes at an emotional cost. That is, they found that people were more unhappy when their thoughts wandered than when they were intentionally thinking about the thing that was currently happening. So an overactive mind creates a sense of dis-ease and distress. Likewise, a mind with more controlled thoughts on the present is less uneasy. How is this related to brain function? Researchers have shown that depression can be characterized as less connectivity between neurons in certain parts of the brain that regulate and process your emotions, more specifically the frontoparietal network. They also found a hyperconnectivity in the default mode network in your brain. The default mode network is a region of your brain that's responsible for self-reflection and emotional appraisal. Emotional appraisal is when you form judgments about a particular situation. So for example, suppose you lose your job and you can't find another one. You could be sitting around thinking about your situation and start focusing on all the negative things that happened to you and come to the conclusion, my life sucks. What's the point? That's one appraisal. Another situation could be that you're thinking about your situation and you think, I hate this. I've got to find something else to do. Maybe I need to switch careers. What else can I do? How can I make that happen? Do I need to get more training? The first appraisal is more negative and hopeless. The second appraisal is more hopeful and problem-solving focused. So with depression, you selectively focus on the negative things and wallow in the negative self-appraisal. This is rumination. You can just get lost in the negative thinking. And we see this with the hopelessness of depression. You get this tunnel vision that blocks out the positive thoughts, and you get locked into this negative world in your head. So depression equals loose connections in the frontoparietal network and tight connections in the default network. The end result is poor ability to regulate your mood and too much time ruminating on negative things. Here's where mindfulness comes to the rescue. Because mindfulness helps reduce the self-critical thoughts, it strengthens the connectivity in the frontoparietal network and weakens the connectivity in the default mode network. Now, this, of course, is a simplified explanation. If you really want to get into the details of how this happens, look at the reference that I have in the description. But here's an even bigger point in how it can really help treat depression in the long run. Researchers have shown that not only does the practice of mindfulness help during the period that you're doing it, but if you practice it on a regular basis, you get sustained connectivity and therefore improvement in your depression. What's a regular basis? In the studies that I referenced, the participants completed an 8-week program of doing mindfulness exercises on average of 30 minutes to an hour a day. Now, I realize even 30 minutes a day is a lot, and you don't have to start with that. But keep in mind that practicing mindfulness doesn't always have to involve sitting in a room with your eyes closed in quiet meditation. You can be in a mindful state in your day-to-day activities. The Mindfulness Attention Awareness Scale is a questionnaire that researchers use to get a sense of a person's baseline level of mindfulness in their everyday activities. And some of the items used on the measure are as follows. I forget a person's name almost as soon as I've been told it for the first time. And I tend to walk quickly to get where I'm going without paying attention to what I'm experiencing along the way. Can you relate to any of these things? These are just a couple of examples of how you can mindlessly engage in everyday activities. And the real practice of mindfulness will involve not only having quiet time, but learning how to be more present and aware throughout your day. So back to the issue of whether or not it's better than medication. For some people, it may be a better option given the potential side effects of medication. However, it doesn't have to be an either or. You can practice mindfulness alongside of your medication treatment. Then, once your episode resolves, your mindfulness practice is something you can use to help keep you out of a depression. You can see a therapist who specializes in mindfulness-based cognitive therapy, but to do this on your own, the easiest way to start is to do guided meditations where you listen to someone talk you through the process. And I want to help you get started with this. I have an audio download of a guided meditation, and I challenge you to set aside 5 to 10 minutes each day to pull away from the busyness of life and be mindful. There is a lot more to mindfulness, but for now, this can help you get started. And I'll have the Mindfulness Attention Awareness Scale for you as well, just so you can get a sense of your own level of mindfulness. These things are free. All you have to do is click the link in the description that will take you to my website. Follow those instructions to get the download. If you're already a part of my email community, then the meditation and the awareness scale will already be waiting for you in your inbox. Share this video with someone who you think could use it and talk to me in the comments. See you next time.